one of those sheets with the songs on it. If you raise your hand, one of the ushers will be glad to give you one. So good morning, and welcome to Second Baptist Church. To all our friends and visitors, thank you for choosing to worship with us today, and we're so glad that you're here. And first of all, praise the Lord for the rain. It was a beautiful week.
Yes.
There's a number of announcements that you can check in your bulletin today. To highlight just a few, we will be holding something new, a folk encounter, Singspiration, on next Friday, July 14th. So please join us at 7 o'clock in the sanctuary for a fun evening of singing, followed by an ice cream social. Also mark your calendars, we have an all-church picnic coming up, and that will be held after worship on Sunday, July 30th. We'll have more details coming. There's going to be a worship leader training today and Wednesday, July 12th. So for all the current worship leaders and those interested in being worship leaders, please try to attend either the Sunday session or the Wednesday session. You don't need to attend both. Today's session will be at 5, and that's a different time than was listed previously. Or the one on Wednesday will be held at 7. Finally, there will be an executive board meeting on Thursday, July 20th at 7 p.m. So today is also Celebration Sunday, so let's get to the July birthdays and anniversaries. For July birthdays, we have Nancy Comer, Renee Holden, Richard Terrell, Brad Pope, Laura Lyons, Dee Roars, Vince Murphy, Danelle Johnson, Winnie Dowding, Weldon Nelson, Ann Callahan, Joe Wilcox, and Julia McCord. Did we miss any birthdays? Okay, we'll move on to the anniversaries, which are Chris and Becky Brenforder, John and Nancy Comer, Ron and Nancy Schwarzenbach, Mike and Michelle Johnson, and Jeff and Christy Horstman. Any anniversaries we missed?
We have our 25th this year in July.
And there we go. We'll need to make sure we add that one, Kay. Okay. And to celebrate with us, happy birthday.
No,
oh,
okay. Just anniversary.
Okay, but we will sing happy birthday to the crowd.
Okay.
Okay. Christ himself gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the pastors, and the teachers to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Please pray with me. Almighty and everlasting God, who has built your church upon the foundation of the apostles and the prophets, with Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, we ask you to inspire the church universal with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all who confess your holy name may abide in your truth and live in unity and godly love. Through Jesus' name, amen. Please stand and join me in singing our worship songs. Let's just praise the Lord. They'll know we are Christians by our love, and the Lord be glorified. All should be on your sheet.
Thank you.
as we sang that song, "They'll Know We Are Christians by Our Love," I remember about 50 years ago when my parents went to the National Convention in Minneapolis, American Baptist Convention. And they came home and they said, "We got this new song that we're going to introduce to the church." And it was this song. So when we talk about this folk sing-along, sing-spiration thing on Friday night, this is what we're talking about. It's that period of time that when I was young, Ralph Carmichael was the big writer of music at that time. And the Billy Graham films were coming out with some of these songs as their theme songs. And all those songs have sort of been relegated to the dusty shelves of a Minister of Music's office or something. I don't know, because you don't see them around anymore. And so just for the fun of it, it's been my dream for a long time just to pull some of those up sometime and just have a sing-along. So that's what it's going to be, very informal, just a lot of fun, especially if you grew up in that era. I think you'd have a good time being part of that. Today, as we enter into a time of prayer, we want to remember those whose names are printed in our bulletin, your bulletin in front of you, and also want to mention that I heard this morning that the son of a woman that had been attending here for a while, Jody Lewis, her son Brad, was diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. And so we want to remember Brad Lewis in our prayers. Also found out this morning that Carol Nelson went into urgent care this morning. She had had some heart problems a while back, some dizziness and that kind of thing. Well, she's having what appears, it could be that again, and so she was into urgent care this morning. So we want to remember Carol. Anybody else? Let's go before the Lord in time of meditation as we prepare our hearts for prayer. Father, we come before your throne today, praising you for all that you have done in our lives, for creating us in your image, for issuing to each one of us a higher calling of serving you, and Lord, through your grace that comes through your Son, Jesus Christ. And Lord, now by the power of the Holy Spirit today, may we connect with you through worship. And Lord, may the Holy Spirit lead us in our understanding, a deeper understanding of who you are. We do come before you today, Lord, praying for those who were mentioned today in prayer. Those we have lifted up to you, Lord, we just pray for the young man who will be having surgery coming up very soon. And for this 19-month-old young boy by the name of Luke, who is hospitalized. For Troy's friend who was in a car accident. For Marty Parks, who was diagnosed with Alzheimer's. And for the Onweiler family, friends of Myla. God, we just pray that you will also be with the young woman, Angie, who is pregnant and has heart failure. We pray, Father, for each of these individuals today, Lord. We lift them up to you. And for those who are struggling with cancer, Father, we pray for Sean Blunt and Bill Melcher, for Bill Prather, for Anna Plank, for Jamie Hoppen, Samantha Bliss, and for Brad Lewis, Lord, I also wanted to give you thanks today, Lord, for Judy Dickey's diagnosis that what she thought might be skin cancer was benign, and we're thankful for that, Lord. We're thankful, Lord, today for the many answers to prayer. But Lord, we do lift up today Carol Nelson as she is receiving treatment this morning. We pray, Father, that you'll be with her and help the doctors and the nurses as they diagnose what is ailing her. We continue, Lord, to lift up those who have had surgeries. I pray for Weldon Nelson, who is recovering right now in rehabilitation. We pray for his wife Martha, and just pray, Father, that you will bless both of them and bring healing to their bodies. We pray today, Lord, for your continued healing for Aubrey Hogemeyer. We pray, Father, that you will heal her body from this illness that has been plaguing her for a long time. We continue to pray for Peggy Prey and ask God that you will help her over this bronchitis. We thank you, Father, for the many blessings that you bring into our lives, for our congregation. We thank you, Lord, that we can Sunday after Sunday celebrate who you are and what you have done. And God, that you have called each one of us to serve you, Lord, and to operate under the power of the Holy Spirit and accepting the challenges and accepting the possibilities that you have issued to each one of us through the calling and through our spiritual gifts. Bless us, Father, today as we continue in this time of worship. May your Holy Spirit lead us, guide us, and strengthen us. And now, Lord, we pray together in unison the way you taught your disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
hymn, Singing to God Be the Glory. It's either on your sheet or on page 66 in the hymn.
For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you through his poverty might become rich. We're going to receive our tithes and our offerings at this time. Let's give generously to the Lord today through our act of worship. give you thanks for the blessings that you pour out to us every day of our lives. And Father, it's in response to your deep love for us that we come and worship today. It's also in response to your deep love that we give through our tithes and our offerings so that others can be blessed by our own lives. Thank you, Father, for all that you have done. We ask this in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
Today's scripture is from John 17. Jesus has prayed for himself, he's prayed for the disciples, and then he's praying for us. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one. Father, just as you are in me and I am in you, may we also believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me. May we be brought to complete unity to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world. Righteous Father, though the world does not know you, I know you, and they know that you have sent me. I have made you known to them and will continue to make you known in order that the love you have for me may be in them, and that I myself may be in them. May God bless the reading of the scripture.
If you are going to participate today in the worship leader seminar, we'll be meeting in the multi-purpose room, which is right next to the elevator. Should be easy to find. So we'll be back here at 5 o'clock today for that. The great American evangelist, one that I think most of us recognize his name, D.L. Moody. One day he was sitting in his study and his five-year-old boy followed him into his study. Moody was busy writing, probably a sermon, and finally he realized that his son was there, and he looked up and the boy was just staring at him. Moody said, "Well, what do you want?" And his son said, "Nothing, Daddy. I just wanted to be where you are." I get the feeling that that's the meaning behind today's scripture. Is that Jesus just wanted to be where his father was. And that's this whole prayer that we read in John 17. Powerful prayer. I always thought that it should be called the Lord's Prayer. And the other one should be called the Model Prayer or the Disciples' Prayer or something. Because I feel like John 17 was Jesus, we just see his heart in such a powerful and pure way. And that he just wanted to be with his father. I really don't know where it was that Jesus uttered these words. I don't know that anybody knows for sure where these words were spoken, but it appears that it was sometime after they left the upper room where they had what we call the Last Supper together, where Jesus washed his disciples' feet. And many Bible scholars suggest that it may have been while they were walking over toward the Kidron Valley up to the Mount of Olives where there Jesus continued in prayer. Some Bible scholars suggest that they left the upper room at the conclusion of John 14. And as they walked along, that they might have gone past a vineyard. And that's where Jesus might have given that great metaphor of the vine and the branches. But we really don't know. Much of the words of Jesus that seem to fill the pages of chapters 15 through 17 took place, we think, perhaps, as they walked along the road. What we do know is that the disciples witnessed the power and the intimacy of prayer. They saw it firsthand in what Jesus was doing. They would later on find out how vital prayer really is in their own journey, their own walk. As Christians, as they face obstacles, as they face persecution, prayer is a vital part of the Christian life. I wish I was better at prayer. I don't think I'm a very good prayer warrior. I'm more of a task-driven person, and that pulls me away from the time, a lot of the time that I should spend in prayer. And I hear the same thing from a lot of pastors. But prayer is a vital part of the body of Christ.
Yes.
Undoubtedly. Prayer ought to be central to our very existence. And I'm afraid that most of the time, it is not. Prayer is not something we practice as a form of magic to conjure up things that we want. But prayer is not some kind of a religious exercise that we do simply because we ought to. Prayer is merely communication with the God who made us. It's participating in a relationship with the one who loves us more than we can ever imagine. Another aspect of prayer is the public prayer, anyhow. You hear me praying here every Sunday, and what we call corporate prayer, where the body of Christ prays together as a group, as opposed to individual prayer, where you're in the quietness of your home or at your dinner table or wherever praying. Corporate prayer is one where we as a church come before the throne of God to pray. We discover our passions. We discover the purpose of whoever's praying. It's kind of a window into the soul of the person who is praying when we have this corporate prayer. We recognize their deepest desires, their highest priorities. And I think it must have been that way to some extent with Jesus, because obviously this was all written down by those who observed it, John is the one that observed it. And so it was a private prayer by Jesus, but it was also a public prayer because it was observed and recorded. As Jesus was nearing the end of his ministry and was about to be arrested, his response was to pray. While this appears to be a private prayer between he and his Heavenly Father, it's observed and we are able to look in on what he had to say. First of all, it was common for dying or departed leaders, whether it's prophets or rabbis or whoever it was, would often give their farewell final words of instruction. In Deuteronomy 32 and 33, we see Moses' final words of instruction. When Aaron, when he learns how to sacrifice and pray on behalf of the people, in Leviticus 16, we see Moses prays again on behalf of the people. And in the following verses, 15 through 19, he offers prayer and sacrifice on behalf of his people. We discover that Jesus prays in a similar manner. Number one, he prays for himself. I think we should all certainly pray for ourselves. That seems to be the most obvious thing that we do, is pray for our own needs and so on. But the thing that Jesus prays for here is far deeper than just helping us with this problem or that problem, but rather it's an act of pouring out his heart in worship to his Heavenly Father. And secondly, as Joyce read today and as she clarified in the beginning, he not only prayed for himself, but he prayed for his disciples. And then finally, he prays for all of those who will believe, which I believe is the future, which is the church. It's us. I don't know if it's about you, but I think it's a powerful, powerful meaning to realize that Jesus prayed for us. That he took time before he went to the cross with all that he had on his mind, grieving his own death. We know that just a few minutes later, as he was kneeling in the Garden of Gethsemane, that he prayed, "Lord, if it be your will, let this cup pass from me." He went willingly to the cross, but I wouldn't say he wanted to. Not in any human expression or human way. And so in that time that he was looking to the cross, he took time to pray for us, the church. Instead, his prayers were dominated by one single great thought that we see woven throughout this entire passage, and that is the unity of the people, the unity of the disciples, the unity of us who live today. Jesus first prays that he will be glorified. What does it mean when Christ asks to be glorified? The Greek word here is doxazo, where we get the word doxology from. And that means to venerate, to bring homage, or to bring praise. And that's when we would sing the doxology, or when we sing many of the praise songs and the expressions that we pray. To me, doxology is the ultimate praise song. It's lifting our praise to God. Jesus wasn't into some kind of a self-promotion here. He wasn't here to honor himself. He wasn't here to build himself up. It was not a self-promotion campaign. But what he was trying to do is to honor his Heavenly Father. By him going to the cross, God would be glorified. By him praying these prayers, God would be glorified. By the way he lived his life in teaching and training the disciples, and God was glorified in everything that he did. Secondly, he's not only glorifying the Father, but he prays for his disciples. He was aware that his disciples had a difficult road ahead of them. In many ways tragic, because those disciples would go to their death because of the gospel. So he prays for him. And although the disciples were filled with the power of the Holy Spirit at Pentecost, they would still face every form of suffering and persecution and even execution in the end. He also knew that these disciples were God's instruments. And they were selected for the purpose of bringing the good news of Christ into the world. Jesus knew that the church would never make the impact on the world that he wished it to make unless spiritually the world saw that the church had a oneness and unity. The church had to see us, the church, or the world had to see us, the church, as unified. Mm-hmm. The churches of our world have quite often not taken this very seriously. I know some churches that for years and years have had conflict, have had difficulties, have had selfishness and there's some really ugly stuff going on within congregations that they did not take seriously the words of Jesus about being one. I'm so grateful this congregation is a unified congregation. We seem to be unified. And God has been good. God has been faithful in helping us to remain that way. I want you to notice that in verse 11, Jesus prayed for the unity of that original disciple group. And this was no easy task for those early disciples, and Jesus knew it. That is, it was no easy task for them to be unified, to be one. Because in that original group, there had to be incredible tensions at times. If you remember the stories of the disciples, tensions created by James and John when not long before this, they had asked for seats at the right hand of, and the left hand of Jesus in his heavenly kingdom, which caused an outrage of jealousy among the other disciples. It would have had to have done so. Earlier in the same evening, the disciples were fuming with rage because there had been an argument among them as to who would be the greatest. In fact, in that little group of disciples, there was likely all kinds of tensions just knowing who they were. Matthew, the publican, the tax collector, had sold out to Rome and was collecting taxes for the very brutal Roman Empire. And within that same group is Simon the Zealot, who had pledged to kill people like Matthew. In fact, they were part of a guerrilla warfare type of a group that would seek out and find those who worked for the Roman government, and they would kill them. And so here is a group of men who all responded to the call of Jesus to follow him. And yet they had this baggage that they had to leave behind. Mm-hmm. Now we don't get any impression at all that these political differences became a problem to the disciples, because they were so focused upon Jesus Christ and his ministry. And so it should be with us today. When we have difficulties and when we have political differences and so on, we should be so focused upon Christ that none of the rest of that ever matters to us. But it's no wonder that Jesus prayed for that original group of 11 disciples. Lord, make them to be one. It wasn't all, though. He moved beyond the 11. And he prayed for the generations to come. He prayed for us. In verse 21, he prayed for them. He then prayed for all believers. And we need to note here that Jesus asks God to give us unity. And that means that unity is given and it's not achieved. I believe that unity is given to us by the power of the Holy Spirit. It's not something that we can go out and master on our own, because we're going to fail. We're going to get tripped up. The unity of God's people can never be fabricated by humanity. It must be generated by the Holy Spirit. It can never be organized by the church. It must be vitalized by the Spirit of God. And I think the congregations that have had long-term conflicts, it's a result of those congregations not having the availability of the Holy Spirit in their lives so that they could love one another.
That's right.
As Jesus loved us. The pattern for the unity of believers is unlike anything else on earth. We don't find it anywhere else. It is nothing less than the unity of the Father and the Son that becomes our model. It's not merely a unity of organization or purpose or feelings or affection or anything else. Just as the Father is in the Son and the Son in the Father, we are to be so related in the Church of Jesus Christ. Finally, Jesus prays for the impact of a unified church. We live in a world of disunity. There's no question about it. It's interesting to listen to the news and to hear news commentators that may or not be Christians, but they're using some of the same language that we use in a congregation that is going through conflict. Words like disunity, words like of division, and these kinds of words that we quite often find in our own nomenclature. We find disunity everywhere in our homes and families, in workplaces, in local, state, and national government. We find it everywhere we look anymore. Some believe if we could just get the same, a united theology, that we can all believe the same thing, then everything would be okay. That somehow if the church all believed the same thing, that the world out there looking at us would be compelled to follow Jesus. But united theology was never promised to compel the world to believe. Human eloquence will not compel the world to believe. No matter what kind of sermon you hear or what kind of convincing language you use, it will not convince the world to believe. The size of our churches will not do that. We will never compel the world to believe. No denominational program or slogan or goal will compel the world to believe. Only one single thing will compel the world to believe, and that is the supernatural oneness that occurs in the body of Christ, the family of God.
Amen.
A truly unified community of people is a supernatural occurrence that must have a supernatural cause. The world is so disunited that a perfect unified church compels the world to confess that God is at work among us. On the other hand, a disunified church reverses all the work of Christ. Mm-hmm. Do you know that?
Yes.
When the world looks at a church that is broken and sees that disunity, I hear it all the time from people. Oh, I don't have anything to do with the church. All they do is fight, or all they do is they do, you know, they got this long list that they've memorized of things that the church does that is disquieting to that person. Unity is not a secondary issue. It's a primary issue to all of us. It's the very last thing that Jesus prayed about before his arrest. And so it means that I must act now to see that the church is one. It's up to us to respond to the Holy Spirit so that we can be people who are unified. The need for this kind of unity is not only needed in the church, but also outside of the church. Do you realize that every Sunday, all over our area, there are people at home because on Monday morning, they've heard Christians go to offices and plants and factories and criticize their church or criticize other believers, and it's made them cynical. It's deafened their ears to hear the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's why a lot of people are not in church on a Sunday morning. Now, there are other reasons too, don't get me wrong. But that's a biggie, is when they look at people who are supposed to be believers, and that's what they see is disunity. We are the church. It's an awesome and almost scary calling in our lives is to be the church. To think that the body of Jesus Christ is made up of you and me, That's a scary thought. But it's also an awesome thought. It's an amazing calling. It's who we are. Jesus prayed for us 2,000 years ago on that night that he was betrayed and arrested. And we were on his mind. The Spirit makes us one. Not of our own efforts. We are one by the nature of our position in Christ as sons and daughters of God. And we need to live it out. We need to demonstrate it to the world so that the world might know. Amen. This morning, if you do not know Christ as your Savior, if you've never received Jesus into your life, I hope that's the first thing that you do, that right where you are seated today, that you will do that. And if you would like to join in the membership of Second Baptist Church, I'd invite you to come down the aisle this morning and present yourself for membership, that you can join and be part and be unified with this body, the church. Let's stand together as we sing. 447. Sunday downstairs in the fellowship hall. I encourage you to come down and enjoy some refreshments together and some fellowship. As you go from here today, may the Lord walk with you. May we be a light into the world around us, showing the unity of Jesus Christ as we go. Amen. Let's sing together our closing song. If we know it, I guess it's on the sheet.